Hey, my is brother.
Hey.
How's it going? Is that working? That's great.
Oh, okay. So it was the camera? Or, I mean, it was the connection?
I think it's the same still, but that's all right.
Oh.
That's okay.
Well, we tried.
We tried. That's okay. No problem. Nice shades, bro.
Thank you. Thank you.
And you're looking pretty schwank there. You had a good day? Well, it's actually like, what, 8 in the morning for you?
Yes, it is. Yeah. So, I mean, I got up at about 7 and fixed some coffee and set up the room a little bit and, you know.
Beautiful.
All right, yeah.
So, brothers and sisters, welcome to the Rules of Engagement, where we're dealing with just topics that Natsarim want to talk about. Behavioral things generally, like we're talking about the rules of engagement, like engaging something, like our walk. It's generally about our walk, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And we need to be concerned for each other and not worry so much about the various things that people want to do. You know, we can't be concerned with our ideals. We have to be concerned with Yahusha's ideals and what he was trying to teach and his message. And we also need to be spreading his message to the rest of the world. That's our mission. We are a nation that is sent to the nations of the earth. You know, and we can't be like Jonah and run away from Nineveh, because that's our mission. We're supposed to go to Nineveh. And Yahusha was accused for sitting among, you know, thieves and robbers and so forth, and they accused him of being a wine drinker and all this stuff, but he was doing exactly what he should have been doing. You know, but yet they're going to accuse him, and they're not going to the nations, and they're going to accuse him of going to the nations and spreading his message.
Hmm.
You know.
Yeah.
Fantastic. So yeah, that's what it's all about.
Yeah, yeah. It's really, really jumpy tonight. it's like we're on the other side of the world or something.
I think we are. I think we are, man.
I think we have like a 3-second delay.
Oh no.
Hmm.
You're coming through perfectly, though.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, well.
There's nothing wrong.
Well, I can put up with it. No worries. Well, we had a request on our last Rules of Engagement, Episode 1, from a young believer, and she was saying that she's seen a lot of things we've put out about marriage, but she's a single person, and so she was wondering what Torah says about dating and things like that. And so what are your views on those sort of things about, because you're not married yet, and
no.
Do you have a girlfriend?
Not currently.
So those sort of things are on the mind of a 20-something person, whether male or female. So what are your views on that? Are you actively sort of thinking, looking, putting yourself out there, or will you just leave it up to Yahusha? What are your views on those sort of things?
Well,
do you think we should take our glasses off?
I think I'm going to take my glasses off. And then I have to say that the when it comes to that sort of thing, you know, you want to be led by Yahusha. You don't want to try to enforce your own will, because he will lead you to the person that you're supposed to be with, if you let him. He will always lead us if we allow him to lead us. We have to allow him to do it. And the thing is that you do want to be active. You have to put yourself out there and be ready for it, because it'll never happen if you're not there. You know, if you're not actually like telling people, or at least giving the impression that you're looking for somebody, if that's what you're doing, if you're looking for another, if that's what you're doing, then you need to be out there. But you can't be just trying to, we really need to find somebody that already is in the covenant with Yahuwah. We really, that's preferred because it makes everything a whole lot easier. You're trying to keep the Sabbath and trying to obey Torah. It's a lot easier to do it with somebody that is already in the covenant. And that for us, that makes it even more difficult and as far as dating, because we're, the Natsarim are spread all over the planet. Where do you go? And I guess you could also teach someone, but that's, that's a little bit risky because it's like, well, you don't want to get involved with them until they're in the covenant, they've been immersed, and they've accepted it fully in their heart, the truth. You could teach somebody and then at some point later in time marry them. But that almost seems as unrealistic as finding another Natsarim, period. It all seems very difficult. It's not going to be easy. Let's just say that. So in that sense, it is really up to the Creator. We can't, we can't disregard His act in all of this,
That's interesting because Harry, who I was interviewing the other night, he sent an email through later on that said, I forgot to tell you this on the show, but he said my fiance and I actually married before Yahuwah. We agreed to be married, and we've made that covenant with each other, and but because she was doing something else on the other side of the country, whatever, and they didn't want to sleep together, and simply because they didn't want to fall pregnant before they'd had a marriage, because their parents are religious. They didn't want to disrespect their parents and have them upset if they did happen to fall pregnant and they hadn't been married by the, the world standard. So, well, that's nice if they wanted to honor their parents like that. Because, to Yahuwah, once you consummate, you're married. So,
right,
but I thought that was interesting. And he was saying things like, he thought if you did find an understanding Christian or somebody like that who you were talking to and you did want to date, fair enough, but he said, similar to you, he probably would not agree with marrying them while they're in that state because it'll just get really hard. If you want to, he thought it would probably be okay if you found an understanding person to date, but I guess that's, then dating's one of those things, I guess. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts. Before we came into being Natsarim, we were taught in the circus we were in that dating's really just no such, it's not on. That was the teachings we were going along with. But earlier on, when I had different girlfriends and things, Chris opened a book. I don't know what sort of book it was. Probably a dictionary. And he said, look up kissing, Mark. Okay, sure, because everyone's allowed to kiss these days. That's nothing. So I looked up kissing, and I can't remember what it said, but da 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 da. And then he said one of the explanations under kissing was will lead to coitus. And he said, what do you think of that? Will. I said, well, yeah, that does make sense. So he said, so should you be doing it? I said, well, I guess not. Yeah, not been a married. So that was, of course, that didn't stop me, even with my current, even with my wife when we were dating. It's just hard. We didn't date. We just decided to get married, and we got engaged and did it the worldly way because that's all we knew. But it's, couldn't stop kissing. But fortunately, we managed to stop it at that. But it's true. When you're kissing, kissing just leads to other things. So it's very, it's, I would teach my children, because they're at a young age now, and we say to them, you know, because if they see mummy and daddy kiss, you know, if I come home, they see mummy and daddy kissing, say, make sure you don't do that to anybody. Because they, you know what the kids are like, they go, ooh, you know. And, you know, so don't, make sure you don't do that unless you're married, you know. And because my kids, they run around the house and they pretend to be mummy and daddy. And you, who's going to be mummy today and who's going to be daddy today? I said, don't do it when you're pretending to be mummy and daddy either with your friends around the neighborhood. Don't be pretending either. So,
right.
What do you think about, what do you think about that?
Well, I mean, I don't really have too many thoughts on that necessarily. I believe that at some point you do need to make a connection with somebody. Actually, I'm kind of baffled by that. I don't really know what to say. I've never heard that before. The kissing would be an issue.
Of course, I would not be upset if my child was, you know, agreed to marry somebody and I saw them kissing. That wouldn't upset me. You know, I mean, I think that's even if in this day and age, I think that would be a rule that's almost hard not to break, because it's almost like it's a way to express how you feel about somebody, you know, like, you know, just it's, holding hands is very 1950s, isn't it? So it's, I'm not saying that, you know, sexuality and things should flow with the times. It should stay where it's supposed to stay. The standard should be Torah. But I think, you know, I think people are going to come into this walk and they're going to come in with their baggage, they're going to come in with their sins, and they're going to come in, and it's just a matter of saying, well, you should wash as you clean, just pick up where you came in and, you know, sin no more, do your best to sin no more. So,
yeah.
Yeah. But you were, you look a bit baffled by that. I'll move on to something else.
Oh no, I mean, I'm fine. I'm just a little bit thrown off by the idea of kissing being a problem, because I've never thought about it before. I suppose that you're right, but what I would have to say about it is that, well, as long as you're strong in Torah, and you know that as soon as you do something that's more than kissing, let's just leave it at that, then, you know, you've made the covenant with that other person. That's it. And you're married now. Yeah. And, you know, Yahuwah hates divorce. So it's not like you should really ever try to get out of that. It's it.
Yeah.
You
mentioned in a few emails ago about, we discussed it before, and, we've had friends that have got married recently, and they decided to get married according to the state simply so they could get passports and things with their same name on it, so they could travel and stuff, which is probably common sense in a way. You seem very passionately against the state. I didn't kind of grasp why, though. I know it's not important according to Torah, but you seemed unusually against it. Why was that?
Well, there's actually a number of reasons. First of all, the state has nothing to do with marriage. I mean, you know, what is its purpose in marriage? It's not defined by the state. It's defined with our Creator. And see, one of the reasons why the state even gets involved with marriage is simply because the Roman Catholic Church got involved with marriage. And they wanted to have that control. They want to control the people. So, you know, that's my first reason, is like, well, why are they even involved? And the second reason is that oftentimes I've heard, and I've kind of witnessed this myself, couples that get married by the state, there's something that happens in the relationship. It's almost like as soon as the marriage takes place, you've had the marriage ceremony, and the man and the woman realize that, you know, now, okay, now we're married. officially, you know, even though it's not really, that's not the marriage, you know, you stood before some man and he said, you're married. That has nothing to do with marriage. And so if you do get married officially like that, there's almost like this mindset that takes over, and sometimes it can actually be detrimental to the relations between the husband and wife. I've just heard of this, and I've witnessed some occasions of this happening. You know, I've heard people tell you, well, you know, everything was fine before we got married, and then we, you know, got officially married by the state. They were married before under Yahuwah's eyes, and then they get married by the state, and suddenly now their relationship is just, you know, they start drifting apart. I've just heard of this happening.
Oh, yeah, all the time.
Yeah. And, you know, then the other thing is, though, is that in, especially here in this country, in the United States of America, someone who gets married, they are now bound to the other person financially as well. Mm. If a husband, if a wife wants to leave their husband, they can take a very large percentage of what the husband owns. You know, so it's like, well, you know, now you've got a contract that says, I will pay you if you leave me. I will pay you money if you leave me. It's almost like saying, please leave me. it's kind of silly, and it really needs to be removed from the law, because finances have nothing to do with a marriage. It seems like an incentive to leave, not an incentive to stay. You know, I think if a wife wants to leave their husband, or a husband wants to leave their wife, they need to pay their spouse and say, look, I'm out of here. You know, I mean, I'm not saying that we should ever, ever, ever divorce, because Yahuwah hates divorce. Mm. But I'm saying, as far as a secular matter in the way that this world works, they should have done it the exact opposite of the way it is now. That's all I'm saying.
Well, they don't understand that they are married when they consummate, do they? They all just think they think that they're actually breaking the rules by just shacking up, and they don't realize they're actually doing the right. Well, it's not really the right thing, because they're not with the Creator, but they're kind of doing what you're meant to do: get to know each other and make a commitment. You obviously make a commitment before you move in with someone.
Right,
but and that's they don't realize. They think they're rebelling, but they're actually doing what you're supposed to do.
Right, and so, see, the only problem there is that they don't realize that they're doing that's what they just did, and they need to realize that. As Natsarim, we need to realize that if we have relations with our spouse to be, they are now the spouse. That's it.
Yeah.
And we really need to realize that, because right now in today's world, that's not how it's viewed. No. And you know, that's a problem, because it needs to be recognized.
Mm. Mm. So yeah, I thought that was quite a mature mindset for someone like Harry to say, they made a commitment, because he just calls her, and he even said it on air to me. He said, you know, she's my fiancée. And then afterwards he said, I forgot I was with Natsarim and believers who would understand. Because he's so used to just saying that around his friends and family, oh, we're engaged, because they're going to have a bit of a bash with the family to celebrate it and get married. But he said, we actually made it. He researched it, and as most of us have done, and realized that, you know, and she's become a Natsari as well. So they decided to be husband and wife, but they simply just decided not to consummate because, like I said, they didn't want to upset the parents if they did happen to fall pregnant before they were married. Which I thought that's quite a lot of maturity on such young shoulders to make such a decision like that, particularly when, you know, young people in the heat of passion, you know, it's very wise. I guess because she's on the other side of the country, so it's a bit easier.
Right. That's, yeah, that makes it
a little easier. Mm.
Yeah. So, what are you going to talk about now?
I don't know, brother.
So, on the issue of young people and dating and things, I guess, what else would you say? It's really just... Well, I know myself, I was constantly complaining. I went about 3 or 4 years. Because when I was younger and crazy, I had all the different girlfriends. It was crazy. But then I started coming into more and more truth. It was still Christian truth, but it was just more spirituality. And my friends and girlfriend left me and everything. And so I was just a mess. And that's when we really came into the truth more. And I went 3 or 4 years without a relationship at all. And by the end of it, I was just sort of complaining and... I wanted a wife and I wanted a relationship, and eventually she came along. She was in the assembly with her mum, and it was obvious she was into me, and it all went from there. But, yeah. And because we didn't agree with dating, I just said, let's get married, We're going to go through all the stuff we're going to go through anyway. And neither of us had any money, so we said, well, we'll save up a bit and we'll... We were in this Indonesian circus, so we said, oh, all the aunties can bring a plate. And, I say to clients now, when they've been living together and they've got to get married, we've got to get married. I say, well, you worked out how much it's going to cost? Oh, yeah, $20,000, $30,000. I say, well, how about you spend that on a deposit for a house?
Right.
And they say, oh, we've already got a house. So how about you go around the world? It's a party. Why would you spend so much money on a party,
Right.
With people that you're going to look back and go, who was that? I spent $200 per head and I don't even know who that person is. I see what you mean about the... A lot of it's pagan, but even a lot of it's just stupid.
Yeah. I would just put that money back into the bank. Just let it sit there. Don't use it.
Yeah,
just get the actual wedding. I mean, I understand if you're going to get married officially because you're going to have respect for your parents, officially by the state. You're going to have respect for your parents, so you're going to go ahead and go through with the ceremony. But there's no reason to spend any more than enough to pay somebody to be there officially and do it. You just do it.
That's right. So,
Let's try to make it as cheap as possible.
That's right. So, are you looking for a certain person, or have you asked Yahuwah for, what are your aspirations as far as that's concerned? Would you like to have children and a family, or? Are there things you think about often, or?
I do think about it at times. I'm not really sure where my life is going in that direction right now. Mm. It's kind of confusing because, I don't really have enough money to actually have my own house and be supportive. And I was trying at one point to, get into start a business or something or move into something that would make some money. And it wasn't working out for me for the longest time. I was working with my brother and we were both trying to figure out ways that we could make money. We didn't want to work for anybody because that's kind of like a nightmare. Not only now are you having to deal with the boss, but you're also having to, your boss is going to have you break Sabbath, it's kind of hard to work out. So for the longest time, I was trying to make some money and get on my way with, my own career or whatever. And then now it's just kind of, I don't even know where it is. I can't even describe where it is right now because I'm back here living with my parents and, I don't have any money.
Yeah.
It didn't work out. And now what I've decided to do is just kind of put it in Yahuwah's hands for right now. Just say, you know, if he wants to do something, then, you know, I'll, you know, I'm doing exactly what I believe he wants me to do for the moment. And maybe marriage will come along later on in life. You know, I'll find somebody that, you know, wants to do that.
Mm. You were thinking of opening a computer repair business or something inside your dad's shop, weren't you? Was that his idea?
I think that was his idea.
Yeah.
My brother and my dad always come up with these ideas,
yeah.
And they get real excited about them sometimes. And it's like, I'm thinking to myself, well, that's not exactly realistic. Let's think of why it's not realistic for a second.
Yeah.
But, you know, whatever.
Yeah. But you could do that, could you? You would be trained enough and qualified enough to do that.
Oh, yeah.
That's pretty cool. Computer technician.
Right. I mean, I've always enjoyed building computers and working on them. I'm not so much into software as I am hardware. I know more about the hardware than I do software. Mm-hmm. But I'm not exactly, you know, I can deal with software too. I'm just not, there's just a lot of people that know more about software. They can actually code some of the software, whereas mm-hmm. I can't, you know. I can work with it. I can work with anything that has an interface, though. You know, that's all this is. When you look at a computer screen, that's all it is. This is just an interface. You know, it's just, you know, I don't even know how to describe that.
A visualization of the computer's brain.
Right.
I've seen The Matrix.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know if I have a clue what you're talking about either. I'm just saying silly things. So you could do that. So, I mean, there's a lot of money in computer stuff. Is it just that there's not really a market for it in your suburb? Or do you live in a suburbia? Like, do you have street with houses all around you? Or are you out in the bush somewhere? Are you further out rural?
Actually, we're in a neighborhood that's... you know, the neighborhood is a little bit removed from the main city, but we're not that far out. You know, I mean, there's industrial places nearby, but you know, it's a little bit further out from the city than most people are.
Mm.
You know, but yeah, I mean, we're in a neighborhood.
Mm.
There's a road outside with other houses around us.
So what would be stopping you from? Because there's a lady in Atherton where we came from previously, and that's where Chris and Victoria live. And she later in life, when she'd had her kids and they'd left home, and she's probably 65, 70 now, but she's probably 65. She just did courses. She loved computers, so she did courses, and she just opened a garage door. There's just desks everywhere. She's got computers everywhere. That's because she did an internet cafe too, but desks everywhere. And she's just this old lady who knows how to fix computers. And she just, you know, she does it all cash. And she's just great. She just makes all this money. What would be stopping you from chucking out some flyers and saying, I'll fix your computer?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Or is it just out of space?
It's kind of bizarre. Most people... that have computers, it's like, well, you know, you can work on. I almost don't even know how to approach that. It's like, well, all I know is that dealing with people that are having, you know, some sort of a computer problem, my first advice is buy a new computer. You know, and then buy a new computer, build it yourself, and then you won't have any more problems.
That's too honest. They want you to fix their old crappy one, and you can do that.
And you'll fix it over and over and over
That's
again. And you'll
fine.
fix it 100
That's
times.
fine.
Exactly,
You got to
exactly.
do what the client wants. Even if you think the hairstyle is hideous, you got to do what they want. And then after 4 or 5 times of doing it, they might say to you, "What do you really think?" And that's when you go, "Ha ha, I think your hairstyle is hideous." So, and they might let you do what you want because they trust you.
Right.
So,
right.
yeah, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. You're right. I guess right now I'm in my at this point in my life, I'm because see, like, for instance, my brother and I, we tried that too. We actually did try to start a company that pretty much did everything. We were, you know, we'd fix your computer, we'd build you a website, we'd make you a video of whatever, you know, we'll film you or make an animation or
What's wrong with that?
I mean, all that stuff was going on, but see, like, when you're in that kind of work, it's so fickle. It's like people in the technology business, when people deal with technology, for the most part, especially around here, it just seems like they want a giant corporation where they can call somebody on the phone and they get somebody in India that they can't hardly understand and talk to them about the problem that they're having. you know, we did try the technology. The technology thing for a little while, and it just never worked out. And then at one point, my brother, we really didn't actually give it very much time. My brother wanted to jump off of that and onto something else. It was just jump from this, jump to that, jump to this, and
Well, you don't have to worry about him now. What about your options?
right.
You can. It sounds like both of you are similarly trained. Why can't you just do it?
I could just do it.
I mean, software and websites and things, that takes hours and hours and hours. You could probably fix someone's computer in half an hour. Bang,
Right.
bang. You might charge $100. Bang.
Right. Right.
Maybe. That's pretty easy money if you're really good at something.
Yeah.
You could do three. You could do how many computers you could do in a day once you build it up. You could do 6 computers, 3 hours, 4 hours. You know, that's before breakfast. Like,
Well, it's not always as easy as that,
I know.
you
You
know. I
got to
mean,
order in the
sometimes,
parts, and yeah, I know.
yeah, you have to. Sometimes you have to replace things in the computer, and you have to wait for those to come in. And sometimes, like with technology, any technology, and it doesn't matter what it is, you hit these roadblocks. And you can't really like just get it done because of some small little thing that you don't even know what it is, you don't know what's causing it, but something's keeping you from finishing the job. And you will literally bang your head against the wall for just hours and hours and hours in on one customer. Because you have to get the job done. You can't just, you know, you can, I guess, return it and say, "Well, I can't do it. Sorry, here's your computer back." That's kind of like, wow, you know, you just gave up on that, and now you've lost the customer that they'll never come back to you again. And now you've got somebody out there saying, "Well, they couldn't fix my problem." You know, it's just a mess. Nobody understands technology. It's like, well, you know, it can take 30 minutes to fix one person's problem, but then it might take 15 weeks to fix another person's problem. And in both cases, the solution was simple. It's just that, you know,
So
how,
it's
you know,
confidence.
I don't know. You get my meaning though.
It's a confidence
It's,
thing, is it? It's a confidence thing.
No, actually, it's just a logistics thing. It's like, you know, I've dealt with it before. Where you've got somebody's computer and you're trying to fix it and you don't know what the problem is, and then you do eventually figure out what the problem is and you fix it. You get another person's computer and you fix it right away, And then the next person's computer, you're going to sit there for just hours. And it's just like, this thing will never get done. And the customer's mad. And you're just wishing that you hadn't ever gotten involved with this to begin with. I think what I'm saying is I'm just a little bit burnt out with dealing with people in the way that, you know, they react to certain things. You know, they don't understand to begin with, and then you're trying to, as one person or two people, you're just a small group trying to solve something that should be solved by a larger company. And it's like, okay, you know, the larger company will just buy them a new computer and say, oh, we couldn't fix this one, here's a new computer, and, you know, we'll just charge you what we were originally going to charge you, because they have the money to do that if they want to, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, they'll charge them a little more maybe, or just give them that option. I don't know. All I know is trying to do certain things as one person or even just two people, it's not as easy as it sounds. You know.
Wow.
Because I've dealt with that, like, you know, I've dealt with, before I actually got into fixing computers and being able to fix them myself, I had somebody that I would take my computer to, and even they were struggling. I mean, I got mad at them at one point. I was just like, look, I need this thing fixed. And you give it to them, and you're hoping that this person is going to fix your computer, and they don't. And, you know, a few weeks later, you're taking it back to them because they didn't fix it, when the problem was very simple. It's just, you know, just build the computer the right way the first time with the right software and the right hardware working together, and it's done. Mm-hmm. And then, like, the computer I have right now, I won't need to do anything with it for maybe 3 or 4 years, you know. It's fine. It's not having a problem. I built it myself with parts that I got online. Mm-hmm. And, you know.
Yeah, that's the best way, isn't it? We used to buy computers from the generic places, Harvey Norman and places like that. And I took it to the computer lady. She said, that's rubbish. They put this flashy little case on it. But inside it, it's just all crap.
Right.
She said, you should have got me to build you. I said, oh, well, we'll next time. But then we upgraded to Apples anyway. So.
Right, right.
But, yeah.
I don't know. I think right now, at this point in my life, I'm just kind of wanting to give the world a rest. You know, it's seen enough of me trying to do this stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm doing exactly what I believe I should be doing right now. And I believe that firmly. I'm here. I'm trying to support, you know, the ministry, and I'm trying to, you know, spread the commandments and teach the Torah to people, and that's actually kind of working out now. You know, I'm dealing with it in the best way that I know how, and letting the Father guide me. Mm. And for the moment, it's just fine. Go ahead.
What book are you up to?
What?
What book are you up to?
Oh, as far as the reading.
Yeah.
I'm still working on Shemoth. I need to get busy on it. You know, I've kind of let it slack a little bit, but, you know, I'm going to get back on it. Shemoth is Exodus.
Yeah, yeah, second. Yeah. Oh, that's cool. You've done all the Janet. That's cool. Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought it was...
long books, those early ones. That's pretty good.
Right.
Yeah. I fell away from doing the Fossilized Customs one. I thought I was getting a bit burnt out on that. And then the 10th one came out, so I thought, I think I'm going to start again, and I'm just going to not do the visual thing. I'm just going to read it. And I decided I might, rather than having to go through the computer for all the pagan terms, I thought that takes too much time as well. I thought I'm just going to put a note at the beginning that says, any words that you hear whispered are words that are... pagan terms. So for the sake of this book, you will hear them. But so, just so you know, they're not supposed to come off our lips. I thought that's an easy way to just get it done. So people, otherwise people are just sitting there going, oh, J-E-S, what is that? You know, unless they've got the text in front of them. It's,
right.
They won't know what word I'm talking about. So I thought just to get through it, it'll be easier just to whisper it. And, you know, and take a bit of your advice there. So
There's plenty of you know, pagan terms and names and so forth in the scriptures, and I've decided that I'm reading the scriptures, and I'm just going to read them. You know, if somebody wants to get mad at me for doing that, that's fine. But the scriptures, the Torah, had to be read every. What was it, every 7 years or something like that? I can't remember, but there's something about the Torah having to be read out loud. It has to be read out loud. And there's tons of pagan names in there. So what did they do? Did they just go ahead and say them or sit there and go, well, okay, guys, here's this name that I can't pronounce? And, you know, I'll also have to go back to when, I can't remember his name right now. I'm drawing a blank. But he was, it was a servant of Yahuwah who was challenging the servants of Baal. And he was teasing them and telling them, call your deity and have him bring down fire or something. And
was that Elijah? And, Eliyahu?
Eliyahu. I think that was it. Yes. And he had him... you know, he was teasing him about that, and it says that he said, you know, I don't know if what he did, but it says, quoting from Eliyahu, he's saying, call your, you know, your deity, and he named the deity. He said the deity's name. Mm-hmm. Now, he was speaking it, but he wasn't worshiping their deity. Now, you know, I mean, this is getting into subjective material here, but it's just like, yeah. Well, you know, I don't even know what to say.
Yeah, sometimes I understand what you're saying. Sometimes if I'm talking to a client, you know, I'm not going to start spelling heaps of words out. Sometimes I'll just say certain words.
Yeah,
if I can say Messiah instead of spelling J-E-S-U-S, I'll do that. I'll just say Messiah. But depending on what you're talking about, but I think so with certain people, I think you can, if it's a matter of pushing the point, then you know that's the priority. But I think otherwise, if it's just in your daily life and your own heart and your own mouth, then I think, well, why not try to do it? Why not try to overcome the paganism? It's not like you.
Yeah.
Err on the side of righteousness, isn't that what they say?
Yes, that's always a good idea.
But I do understand what the point you're making, yeah, and others have made it too. But I think, well, in your personal life, well, why not try to overcome?
Oh yeah.
So
I'm just saying that, you know, as when I read the scriptures, that's. Yeah. What I'm doing, I'm just going to go ahead and say them. It makes it a whole lot easier because it wouldn't get done if I had to do, you know, each word differently or whatever. You know, it completely destroys the message that's being put out. It's like, well, now you're confused. What are we talking about here? You know, it can actually lead to confusion hearing that, you know, something that's not. You know, it's breaking the flow, is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. So going back to the dating topic, there's a lot of people out there trying to get on messianic, you know. Oh, what are they called now? What are they calling? Sites for getting together with people. What do they call those now? Matchmaker or something like that?
Yeah, matchmakers.
Do you think things like that is trying to control a situation, or do you think you're trying to take control of something there and not allowing Yahusha to do it, or do you think he will flow through those sort of things? Like, because a lot of people are, well, Scripture says if you can't contain yourself and you can't control your sexual urges, then you should get married. Scripture says that somewhere. But so obviously for people who are a bit that way inclined, then they're trying to look for someone to marry. Do you think they should step back a bit and let Yahusha lead, or do you think things like that are a bit sort of control freaky?
I don't see a problem with it. I think you need to find somebody that already is in the covenant, which is, you know, even on the internet, that's kind of hard. But I guess if it's a site that is already filled with Natsarim, you're not going to have a problem. There should be probably a site that Natsarim can all get on and say, well, you know, here, I'm looking for somebody, here I am. I mean, that's because we're scattered. We're all over the earth. So we do need something like that. I think it's a good thing, because it does connect people that are, you know, even as far as on the other side of the planet. You know, I mean, if you really feel that you should get together, then you can still do that, you know. I think the Father will always guide us if we let Him. In all things, He will always guide us. So there can't be really that much of a problem with, you know, at least putting yourself out there on a site like that, you know.
Well, He says somewhere that He'll give us the desires of our heart, doesn't He? And I don't think that's a selfish desire to want to be in companionship with somebody, have a family. I don't think you would class that as a selfish desire, do you?
No, I mean, you know.
I can tell you. It teaches you how to put yourself off. It's the opposite to selfish.
Right.
That's great, man. What else you want to chat about? How's all these Facebook things going?
Oh, they're going pretty good, you know.
Did you take my thing off your forum?
Oh, yeah, I was removing a whole bunch of stuff.
Smash you?
I thought,
did I break a rule or something?
Well, what was going on there is I was just, you know, taking lots of things off because I'm worried about the direction of the group going the way it was meant to. You know, so I just figured I was taking a whole bunch of stuff. I'm trying to be objective in the matter, and I'm trying to be fair to everybody. I'm also trying to not be too harsh. And it's just kind of like, what do? You know, I might not be as qualified as some to run it, but I'm trying my best, you know. I have ticked some people off, though. They did get a little bit mad at me just because I was enforcing the rule a little too harshly, maybe. I don't know.
It's all new to me because I've never been on forums before. I didn't know any of those things.
Right. I mean, generally on a forum, you know, it's a lot more strict on like a forum that you join, just that's not Facebook. Facebook is very open. People seem to think that Facebook is like, well, you can just join this group and then say whatever you want to say, you know. And that's you know, we need to be respectful of the person that created the group and the vision that they saw for the group, you know, because if you join a regular forum on the internet, the moderators will literally ban you from the site because you said something and then, you know, that wasn't okay. They will ban you from the site. But for some reason, Facebook, they're just kind of wishy-washy and just all out there, you know.
Cool.
But yeah, you know, one more thing on the topic of dating there, I just kind of wanted to talk about this just a little bit. You know, we're we're dating each, you know, we would be dating each other. But we're also, at the same time as Natsarim, we're also dating Yahuwah. You know, we're dating the Father right now. Mankind, as mankind, we're dating.
We are too, because we're not married yet. Yeah.
Right. See, exactly. We're going to the wedding feast at the end.
Betrothed.
Right. We are already we're his bride right now. I just think it'll be completed at the end a little bit more. But also, I wanted to talk about how do I put this correctly? It's
just say what you want to say, mate. I can edit it if you don't like it.
Yeah. Well, what it is it's just as humanity from the very beginning, ever since, you know, Adam and Qua, or Adam and Eve, ever since the first man and woman, that was kind of like I know what I'm trying to say. If you take the scriptures and you step back and you view the scriptures as a tapestry, okay? Like, if you open up the scriptures and you look at just a few passages or some words in the scripture, you're looking at, you're viewing the tapestry, but you're rather close to it when you're doing that. And if we step back from the tapestry and look at it as complete piece, you know, we see the entire image, the goal of what it is. And the scripture, it kind of draws an outline of the regular course of any human's life, but in humanity. This is really hard to describe. I'm so sorry. Like, you know, Adam and Kawa, or Adam and Eve, that was almost like conception of the human race, and then, you know, he just kind of, you know, as an infant, you know, once they were out at the garden, you just kind of, you know, you do just kind of let the infant go. You can't really like punish an infant, you know, you can't do anything to an infant. You just kind of have to let the infant go. And then as the infant gets older, you give, you know,
boundaries.
Hold on. give me a second. Okay. So as the infant gets older, you know, it's a child now. That's, you know, you're no longer an infant, and you do start having, you know, the old thing where if you spare the rod, you spoil the child.
Yeah.
So Yahuwah he punished, you know, his people. He did. He was punishing his people. And as he was punishing his people, he was teaching them to fear him. That's the first lesson that mankind has learned is to fear Yahuwah. And we still fear him. Now, as the child grows older, you stop teaching them fear so much and you start teaching them love. And we were slowly starting to learn love, but at one point, the Messiah, you know, Yahuwah came down in human form and he was the Messiah, and he taught us to love each other. And we're still learning about love. And that was almost like this stage in any human's life where you get to be around 13 years old and you're starting to no longer have fear for your parents, and you obey them out of love. You don't obey them because you're afraid anymore. You're still afraid, but you also are now obeying them out of love. And that's kind of like a, you know, just a switch over to that. So now we don't really fear him nearly as much as we did before, because before it was just death and pain if you disobey. But now it's like, well, you're old enough to deal with yourself. You know, he doesn't come down and tell us stuff anymore. Not directly. He doesn't send messengers directly to us anymore. You know, we're on our own. If we make a mistake, that's, you know, on our head, and he will punish us for it at the end. So, you know, it's like when a child becomes 13, their actions aren't really so much on their father's head anymore. They're on their own head. They're an adult now. Or at least that, you know, that's kind of a more of a tradition, but you get my point. It's, and you start obeying out of love, not so much fear. You still fear, but the fear just taught you to obey in the beginning. Now you're obeying out of love. I just wanted to make that connection, because it's like, well, we're also dating Yehua, though, and as we grow up, when we're old enough to actually be married to him as human, as mankind, then, you know, he's going to have the wedding feast, and that'll be the end of it.
Wonderful. I'm sure a lot of viewers might be coming into Israel, and they might be saying, well, what happens if I've already been married and divorced, or what happens if I've slept with heaps of people, or, you know, what happens here and there, and does that mean I have to go and rekindle my ex-husband, or does that mean I have to, you know, which one of all the people I slept with am I really married to? You know, they have all these things.
Well, I would say that if you've been immersed, then you're a new creation. Anything that you did previous to that is erased. Yeah. Now, if you continue to do things along that nature, that would be a problem. But because you're supposed to act like a new creation as well. You're not just supposed to say, oh, well, my sins are forgiven. Okay. No, your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more. That's the end of it. You should be mature enough to do the right thing now. And he will put his commandments and his Torah on your heart. And that will help you to no longer do those things anymore. And you will, and you can go and find, you know, the proper spouse, somebody else that believes Torah. If you're already in a marriage with, somebody else, you need to stay in that marriage. Just because you got immersed doesn't mean that you're no longer married to that person. You know, we should stay in the marriage and try to teach them with patience and love and kindness, especially patience. Just be very patient and just teach them little bits at a time. There's no reason to force anything down anybody's throat. Just teach them slowly and have patience. And lead by example, not so much by our words, but also by our example. But yeah, you should stay in the marriage. But I think if you've been married several times and you're not currently married, and then you get immersed and you've accepted the Father and you've accepted the Messiah, then you're a new creation. You don't need to go back and find anybody unless you want to, unless you want to teach somebody else that you've previously been involved with. You know, that's up to you, but everything's fine. You're a new creation. Just understand that you are a new creation now. And there, it's not like, well, you get a, you know, you should just be careful is all I'm saying at that point. Now you need to be careful. You know the truth and abide by it, you know.
Fantastic. Hope I've been any kind of help today to somebody.
Right. It seems all very convoluted, though, doesn't it? No really right or wrong answer.
Oh well, it's working it all out, isn't it?
Right. Yeah. You're getting pretty sleepy over there.
Yeah, it's pushing midnight. It is midnight. There you go. It's just clicked over midnight.
Yeah, we should probably wrap it up. Shall we put on our glasses?
Yeah, why not?
Hold on, here we go. All right. Oh, we need a little flashy thingy, too.
Yep. Well, how do you want to conclude this second show of the Rules of Engagement, brother?
I think we should conclude as obey Yahuwah, ask Him to guide you, and just remember that if we're following in his footsteps and we're doing what we feel He wants us to be doing, and we're loving our spouse, and we are obeying and paying attention to what we're being led to do, then we're doing the right thing. If that makes sense.
So be it. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for joining us on this second show. We hope you had a gorgeous sleep. So, it's been wonderful. Thank you for hanging out with me, bro.
Yes.
Mm.
Shalom.
Shalom. Until next time. Shabbat shalom for me.
Oh, yeah. Shabbat shalom.
So, love you, mate.
All right. Take care, man.
You have a good day.
Bye.
See you later. We'll be right back.